All right.
Yeah, go ahead. Introduce yourself.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Corey, and today I will be talking to you about vermicomposting, the responsible alternative to synthetic fertilizer use in agricultural, urban, and suburban areas. Okay, let's first look at the linear nature of how we produce, consume, and dispose of our food. This very simplified process shows how our food is produced on an industrial scale in monoculture operations. It then gets processed and then shipped to supermarkets all over the nation. And the next is food that we don't eat, just ends up in a landfill. There are many flaws within this system. One includes the high inputs of fossil fuels, chemicals, and water that are required to maintain these large monoculture operations. Another issue includes the sheer distances our food has to travel to reach our plates. This only increases the need for more fossil fuels and chemicals, such as preservatives. However, one of the most important issues surrounds the undesirable locations in which our food waste ends up. Let it be known that here, waste refers to a potential resource in the wrong place. Such nutrients that can be found in our food waste include nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, or NPK. It's on the bottom. And when they are in the landfill, they are rendered unavailable for useful uses. As we'll see shortly, nitrogen in particular is a readily available and highly useful nutrient found in food waste, and it is the main component of many synthetic fertilizers. Okay. So naturally, there are a lot of issues surrounding fertilizers. The first being that it is quite harmful for aquatic life. Excess fertilizer runs off into waterways where it causes large algae blooms. These algae blooms then cause the water underneath of it to become hypoxic or lacking in oxygen. And this happens because the algae dies, and as it dies, it consumes oxygen, removing it from the water. Another issue surrounding fertilizers is that it contaminates drinking water. Most often it leaches into the water table, where it can get into our water source, and it has been known to cause certain types of cancers and illnesses in children. Fertilizers also have a severely negative impact on soil's fertility. When too much fertilizer is used on the soil, it strips the land of its ability to hold water and nutrients. Also, when too much fertilizer is added, instead of converting that added nutrients into usable forms, the microbes within the soil will convert the nitrates into nitric oxide, or into which is a potent greenhouse gas. However, we don't just see these issues in large-scale monoculture operations. We also see them every day. We even partake in these issues, oftentimes without us even realizing it. So, another linear nutrient system surrounds the maintenance of lawns. There are over 40 million acres of lawns in the United States in which we collectively spend billions of dollars on annually to maintain. Whether it's a yard, a sports field, a park, or a golf course, there is not much difference between a large swath of grass and hundreds of acres of corn. Both require vast amounts of fossil fuels, chemicals, and water. the waste that lawns produce, mainly lawn clippings and rake leaves, are an excellent source of carbon that, once disposed of, are also rendered unavailable. So, what is the solution? In terms of solution, we must connect and transform these linear systems into a closed loop. This would require a shift from a dependence on large-scale industrial monocultures to food production within the confines of the community. To achieve this, suburban lawns and abandoned lots in urban areas would need to be transformed into sustainable gardens and permaculture operations. The outcome, if this were to happen, would be minimizing the total distance food and nutrients have to travel. So the objective of shifting towards this small-scale closed-loop system is to recycle nutrients from the system's own waste into usable forms for plants, thus creating a miniature closed loop of nutrient cycling and eliminating the need for excessive amounts of synthetic fertilizer. Okay, so it's important to understand the basics of the nitrogen cycle, as nitrogen is one of the most prominent limiting factors in fertilizers. So this diagram depicts the movement of nitrogen within the soil. Nitrogen is moved through the soil through biological fixation. Bacteria and microorganisms, as you can see, make up a vast ecosystem. I like to call it a microcosm within the soil. Nitrifying bacteria oxidize forms of ammonia and ammonia to form NO2 and NO3, as you can see here. So it goes from ammonia to nitrites and nitrates. Gentrifying bacteria then reduce the NO2 and NO3 to form nitrogen gas, or N2, which gets released into the atmosphere, as you can see on the left-hand side. Again, when there is too much nitrates in the soil, the microbes will actually convert it into N2O, which adds to the emissions of greenhouse gases. So, the main goal of this project is to investigate and carry out a small-scale waste management system in order to eliminate the need for synthetic fertilizer use on urban and suburban monoculture areas and localized food production, thus sustaining the nutrient cycling within the small enclosed. Other aims include designing a vermicomposting bin that is able to monitor its own moisture, temperature, and CO2 levels, which are parameters vital to decompost's health. And another aim is to investigate the importance of maintaining an appropriate carbon to nitrogen ratio. So, the best management for small scale waste, in my opinion, is vermicomposting. So, what is vermicomposting? It's a way to transform our food waste into nutrient-rich fertilizer, but it incorporates worms that will ingest the material and then break it down in what is called their gullets, which includes grinding mechanisms. And then as it passes through the digestive system, it acquires microbes, and it drastically increases the biodiversity microbial activity of the output. So, more about the worm species used. Acinia foetida, or more commonly known as red wiggler worms, are ideal for vermicomposting systems. Again, they use their gullets to break down the food, and it has and proven that the microbial activity is 10 to 20 times higher than in the soil and organic matter that the worms ingest. So in other words, you get more out than what you do. Okay, so let's get into designing the bin. So on the right is a schematic drawing of the base. The base includes four walls, four legs, two handles, one on each side, the plywood board attached to the bottom that is wrapped in a waterproof tarp. And if you can see right here, there is a hose drain that aids in draining if leaching were to occur. All right, so again, that's a schematic drawing of the stackable chambers of the bin. Again, like the base, it has four walls, two handles on each side, and instead of a plywood on the bottom, it is actually hardware cloth. It's we chose half of an inch, which actually proved to be too big as the worms fell through. So we'll get there. And this is a complete design that I generated myself. I was very pleased at how similar it looks to the actual thing. And then, so these are just some pictures of the bin construction process, some of the materials, me and my family cutting and constructing it. Here are some more. This one is, you can see it, the hardware cloth is stapled around the borders. And as you can see, this is the completed bin. Okay, so in composting systems, especially vermicomposting systems, it is important to monitor the moisture, temperature, CO2, and the humidity of the relative environment with the, surrounding the system. Moisture is important to monitor because the worms need to maintain a moist environment so that they don't dry out. Temperature correlates with the moisture and the respiration, which is determined by the CO2. The higher the CO2, the more active the bin is and the worms are. And now the humidity of the environment is going to determine how fast or not the compost will lose its moisture and its temperature and respiration. So this is the hardware and software that I use to collect this data. It's actually one of these. It's called LabQuest 2, and it has three portals for inserting up to three sensors. It also comes with this user-friendly interface for monitoring and graphing the data over time, in which you can download and then reduce. These are the sensors and probes that I use. So inside the bin right now, there is a soil moisture sensor, and then the picture on the left depicts the orientation in which I placed it into the dirt, or compost. And then the bottom is the temperature probe, and this is the CO2 monitor in which we placed in an empty chamber above the compost to measure the CO2. Okay, so to measure the humidity of the room, we used a radon meter, and that was able to give us a reading of the humidity over a week. We were able to obtain an average. And these are just some pictures of how we set up the data collection system. A 1/2 inch hole was drilled into the side of each layer on this on the back here. The sensors were then fed through the holes and connected to the data logging. Okay, so it's important to balance out your nitrogen and your carbon and nitrogen. An ideal ratio is 25:30:1. High carbon material, or also known as brown material, in our case, is the lawn waste, and high nitrogen material or green material in a system like this would be kitchen waste or waste that comes from various produce and other. Okay, and so if we have too much nitrogen in the system, the compost will begin to smell really bad. And so that is why it's important to make sure that there is more carbon than there is nitrogen relative to the ratio. So in my case, my carbon source, I used sycamore leaves that I got at Avalon Acres. And ratio for sycamore leaves is roughly 70:80:1. For the nitrogen source, I use my own personal kitchen paste. Table 3 shows typical CN ratios of high nitrogen material that I used. And table 4 is a specific material and relative weights. Okay, so this is just a typical result of a week. This was a good week. We found that it is important to maintain a moisture between 10% and 20%, with that the carbon dioxide will remain stable as well as the temperature. Okay. So humidity results from the radon meter. So the average humidity of the lab over the course of the week was 47.2%, which is relatively normal for a cool lab environment. So of course there was some troubleshooting and what you typically look for when assessing the compost, you look for the dryness. When you pick up the compost, it should be moist to the touch, but not dripping. You look for the compactness of the compost. You want to keep that pore space open and keep it turned and fluffy. And it's important to, you know, monitor how many worms are actually in the system. And then, you know, act accordingly. It's too dry, add water. There's not enough worms, probably need to feed them. And then, so how often should you add food? I found that once a week will generally sustain a normal, consistent respiration rate and moisture level in this population. And then some problems that we had were the chicken wire was too large, and the worms would fall through the bottom layer into this compartment where they had nowhere to go, and thus they died. And then they also were able to slip through the cracks in between the layers, and so I attempted to parafilm it, which helped a little. Okay, so in conclusion, what I learned was that with stable humidity, consistent watering, regular feeding, and adequate monitoring, a single household can sustain a vermicomposting system and produce a nutrient-rich fertilizer for use in small-scale growing operations. And you can relate this back to those small-scale closed-loop systems in which the waste in which those systems produce will then be used to produce the food itself. So you have no nutrients leaving the system in large quantities. So to take the project further, I would implement this in my own home. Probably take this home and continue to use it. And another important thing to do is getting the community involved. Community outreach is probably the most important theme, the social context of this project. We can, by getting the community involved, we can pool our excess lawn space and produce enough food to establish food stability within a community. And collecting the lawn waste and food waste from the community can then sustain those naturally, instead of those waste materials getting sent to the landfills where they aren't able to be used by. And so I just want to thank my family for being so supportive. I'd like to thank Kyle Snow, who's not here, but I'd like to thank him for letting me use ample space in his lab. I want to thank Dr. Teal for agreeing to take me on as a capstone student. And I'd like to thank all the ISAT professors because switching to ISAT turned out to be a really great choice that I made, and I've had nothing but great experience. So with that, so are there any questions? Open the floor. Was to fill layers of food as we go. And so the worms are actually going to move up the bin as more food is added on top. So we got to the second layer, but could easily gotten to the third. You guys are welcome to come up and open it up and dig around, smell it. It smells really good when you have the ratios right. A lot better than there.
Can you add more layers onto it as you add more food, like more of the wooden platforms?
Yeah, sure. I could imagine you could make this however how you wanted to, depending on the scale of what you want your clothes loop to be. Again, this is just me and my sister's kitchen and waste and some leaves, and we were able to really large yield of compost.
I was saying this would be really neat for like the residence halls on the JMU campus,
yes.
Especially if you can like scale it up more.
We definitely thought about that.
Do the worms multiply?
The worms I was actually very surprised at the resilience of the worms. I remember one day I came in, I reached my hands in and was able to pull up a handful of worms, but then sometimes, if you let the population dip too low, you will have to. I did have to buy more worms here in the end.
But on average, they do multiply?
Yes.
So there would be a market for blood worms?
You could definitely start a worm farm and profit off of the worms and get multiple uses out of it. Yes?
So is the only difference between composting and vermicomposting just that you have worms?
No, it's actually a much more nutrient-rich product. The worms, when the food passes through the worms, it's going to pick up those microbes and the bacterium in the worms' digestive system. It's going to be followed through in their castings, which is a synonym for vermicompost. And so it's And also the worms will break down the food quicker than the natural processes of just letting compost sit in.
So what would you suggest for the bottom, now that you realized that the mesh was too large, what would you do next time?
I would use smaller mesh, first of all. I would also, I'm not so sure that I would include the bottom plywood piece. Mm-hmm. I would also make it easier to somehow detach and be able to open up that space and see what's actually going on in there, because there's two layers of dirt or compost on top of it.
Any other questions? All right, thank you, Kurt.